Hi, good afternoon. Welcome to Veterans in Politics Canada interview. This interview was with Justice of the Supreme Court, Seat C. We have our candidates here. We invited every candidate, and we have three candidates today, and I would like to have them introduce them to you. We'll start with the lady first. Judge, just your name.
Oh, thank you. So I am Alyssa Kadish, a district judge here in Clark County, presently.
I'm District Court Judge Leon Aberstury. I'm up in the 3rd Judicial District in Lyon County.
I'm Alan Lefevre, and I've been in private practice of law since the 1980s in Las Vegas. It remains so today.
And we want to thank them for being here. And what we'll do is the ground rules is that we have our panelists in front of you who will be asking you a question. You want me to put this on? Sorry. So they will be asking you a question and you'll be answering it. You have a minute within to answer that question. I keep the time. So if you have to go over a little bit, I will give you some leeway to finish the sentence. So I really appreciate that. And I appreciate you guys being here. Panelists, would you please go down the row here and introduce yourself to our candidates and to our people that are watching.
I'm Robert Faust. I have lived here since 1985. I'm a former professional baseball player and coach, and I'm a former U.S. Army combat veteran.
My name is Andre Haynes from EMG. I'm a publicist and also the Southern Nevada Auxiliary Director of VIP.
I'm Mantis Tobago, the co-host of the VIP radio show, and I take care of a former Marine.
My name is Rob Latter. I'm a U.S. Army Military Police veteran. I'm also a journalist, and I will not be voting today out of fairness.
Michael McDonald, former City of Las Vegas analyst, Vice President of the Family Civil Liberties Union, and VIPI Legislative Counselor.
John Moore, I've lived here since 2006, former Nevada Assemblyman, U.S. Army veteran. Thank you for being here.
Okay, panelists, thank you so much. Thank you, candidates, for being here. So we'll start the questions out. We'll go right here now. Mr. Faust.
Okay, so I would ask each of you, what do you think the biggest problem with the Nevada Supreme Court is today, and what would you like to see done about it? Start with you, Mr. Lefevre.
I don't think there's a problem. The court is simply kind of growing into the structure that it has. So we've created this infrastructure of the Court of Appeals, which is an error correction court. And so the Supreme Court has yet not adjusted to the push-up system that they have, so they wanted more mundane things to be taken care of by the Court of Appeals. I don't think that has been fully fulfilled. The Nevada Supreme Court right now, to point out what's wrong, does not have the time and resources to be a court of precedent and establishing precedent as well as it should have, but that's a question of working out the kinks of having a court of appeal. So the court, we don't have a rich history of precedent to guide parties, and so precedent is what guides us, something called stare decisis. And if in time, I think that the, quote, problem will be resolved.
Time, thank you.
So am I next?
Yes.
Okay, all right. So I think that now that the Court of Appeals has been in place for a couple of years, the Nevada Supreme Court needs to do what it said it was going to do, which is resolve cases more quickly than it has been doing and issue more published decisions so we do have established precedent that we can rely on and we can get more consistency in the decisions across the state. Right now, because we don't have guiding precedent on many issues, there are inconsistencies among the decisions you get from our various district judges throughout the state. If we have precedent, not only can we get consistency there, but then attorneys can properly advise their clients. Businesses can determine how they're going to run themselves if they know what the law is. And our Supreme Court needs to make those decisions, getting decisions out and publishing decisions on issues of first impression, their top priority.
I believe the issue with the Supreme Court is they've lost focus of what their mission is. Their mission is to decide cases, resolve issues for the people that find themselves coming to the court and asking for help. The Supreme Court's focus is not on resolving cases. They're more focused on commissions, they're more focused on creating more procedural rules, they're more focused on building buildings all over the place, but they're not focusing on resolving the cases. And what needs to happen is the Supreme Court has to sit down, figure out, the mission is we solve cases. As a district court judge, I can't get away with the backlog. I can't sit there and let cases go on for 2-3 years. Now, does it happen every now and then? Yes. But we were promised that with the Court of Appeals, the backlog would go down. We were promised with the Court of Appeals that 2 positions on the Supreme Court would go away.
Minute.
Andre Haynes, what is one existing bill that impacts the Nevada Supreme Court that you hope the Nevada legislator amends?
And, sorry, who goes first?
You decide.
A bill which you believe deserves amendment?
That you would like to see amended that impacts the Nevada Supreme Court.
Like a bill we would propose?
No, a bill that already exists.
I would propose rule changes to the rules of civil procedure to allow a much more expeditious treatment of cases so that they can move forward. Right now, when you file a case, that means it's going to have a trial. And there are a lot of procedural devices in between. And the Supreme Court needs to tighten up its rules about when district judges can decide things and take an earlier bus stop off the bus as it's headed on its way down to a trial. The rules are inconsistent. The decisions are inconsistent. The district judges do not have the opportunity, nor do the parties, to know with predictability when they can end a case without a trial and involve expenses and attorney's fees, which are ruinous. So if you can't have perfect justice, at least you can have predictability. And that's what really needs to happen with regard to rule changes.
So I'm actually on the commission, which is right now working on revising the Nevada Rules of Civil Procedure. I've been working on that for quite a bit of time through 2017 and now into 2018, which is an important and time-consuming job. But I think along the lines of what we've all mentioned about speeding up the process with the Nevada Supreme Court, one of the things that comes before the court is bar discipline matters. And at present, while many of the cases before the Nevada Supreme Court are resolved by a panel of 3 justices, all bar discipline matters are being addressed by all 7 justices. And I think that some of them at least could be resolved by a panel to help move things along and get things proceeding apace as they should be. So that's one thing I would suggest.
The key focus I would have, I think, where the legislatures let all the courts down is on funding. In terms of funding for the courts in Nevada, we get very little. And every time they want to do a new program, you end up with a hidden tax or fee. For instance, every time a piece of property is recorded, there's a $4 fee for this program, a $3 fee for that program, $2 fee for that program. Listening to your conversations earlier in terms of the justice courts, they're not funded. They have to go out and get their funds through fines, penalties, administrative assessment fees. You know, when the Ferguson report came out and they were stating that we're basically taxing poor people through the justice courts, that was sort of like the scene in Casablanca where the French gendarme comes in and says, there's gambling going on. You know, we need to seriously fund our courts. We have a lot of programs and they shouldn't depend on how many speeders are coming through a justice court to fund them.
Okay, I suppose I'll just ask, Amanda Spoggin, I will ask, I guess my last question again. again, which is where do you stand on Morrissey's law and why?
In terms of Morrissey's law, I talked with several of the proponents on it. I think overall it's a great bill. I think Nevada needs to do more for victims' rights. In terms of the notifications and allowing more and additional testimony in terms of victim impact, I think that will go a long way to helping the courts. And you know, Nevada, we do have some on the books in terms of allowing testimony and sentencing and so forth. But in terms of those notifications and so forth, especially in domestic violence situations or where someone's coming out on a parole for a, you know, a crime they committed 15, 20 years ago, victims need a lot more notice.
I do agree with the proposal to notify named victims when someone is going to be released. That makes a lot of sense to me. And hopefully we can avoid some of the awful outcomes that unfortunately we've seen in this state. Obviously that solves part of the problem. There's a lot more issues to resolve, but I do agree with that concept.
Thank you. I'm in agreement with the concept of notification to victims. It probably needs to go a little bit further. I used to work for a district judge, and he used to be alarmed when inmates would escape from the Nevada State Prison and nobody had told him and he had sentenced them. So citizens certainly ought to have that same type of right. It also has to go a little bit further, though. You have to have some sort of a mechanism so that the if the person does still operate under great apprehension, that they can contact the police. And the law enforcement is going to take it seriously and not just say, well, let's wait for an overt act or a threat or an email or a text. So it's not to criticize the proponents of Morrissey's law, but I think it needs to go a step further. And certainly judges want to know when they send somebody if they when they're out of jail and if they've escaped, especially, and so that certainly we can afford that to citizens.
Thank you.
Rob Lauer, as a journalist, I've noticed the state has a serious problem with transparency. Bar, judiciary, disciplinary committees, all those committees and bars, if there's complaints filed, they're confidential. And unless they're adjudicated against the person, those are kept confidential. We saw a problem with Mr. Graham. He was prosecuted for stealing millions of his own clients' money. There was no, the bar failed to supervise someone who had millions of dollars in a trust account, no audits, and no transparency. We also saw a judge who was being recalled, again, for other issues of transparency, and the Supreme Court ruled that they themselves can't be disbarred. I'm sorry, can't be recalled, excuse me. They can't be recalled. Where do you stand on the issue of transparency as a general rule in litigating cases and public access, specifically public access? Go ahead.
You were mentioning the Commission on Judicial Discipline. I served on that for 9 years in the 90s when the rules were being promulgated. The transparency that you mentioned is solely a result of rulemaking. So policymakers have to be convinced that there's a need for rule change. And of course, the press has a inexhaustible need for information. That's why you're part of the press. So with regard to the initial filing of complaints, it is not done as quickly enough. Matters sit before the commission, they sit before bar discipline. And I can tell you as a former president of the state bar and as a member of the Commission on Judicial Discipline, it's a question of money. And so legislators have to make it a priority to fund.
In terms of transparency, certainly in the court, everything has to be very transparent. We are a public entity. It's not my court, it's the public's court. And so certainly all court proceedings are open to the public, except in very, very narrow circumstances that are specifically prescribed, and only in those very limited circumstances would I even consider excluding the public from court proceedings. And it's very important that we have the public reporting on our proceedings. Ultimately, that's what gives the public confidence that the court is actually serving them properly. If they don't have access and don't see what we're doing, how on earth are they going to know and have that trust and confidence? And ultimately, our whole society depends on that trust in our judges and the rule of law. So we need to be open and transparent to make sure that happens.
In terms of judicial discipline, I'm currently on the judicial discipline panel as an alternate member, and I'd agree with Mr. Lefevre. A large part of it is the money. And the legislature hasn't been forthcoming. It's gotten better over the last couple of sessions, but it could be better. In terms of the transparency of the court, I think some of the recent decisions, such as you mentioned, the recall decision, where we're finding out 30 years after the Judicial Discipline Commission was voted on, we gave up our right to recall judges in the state of Nevada. Now, as a judge, I like that. You know, it's one less thing I have to worry about. But as a citizen and someone who votes, that decision had a huge impact. So now, if you have a problem, you have to go to judicial discipline, which is underfunded, and there's a conundrum there. And so, and I think the other transparency issue was the bill in terms of the two of the seats that are on this thing. We were promised that the Court of Appeals was passed, two of the seats would go away. Didn't happen.
Hi, I'm Mike McDonald. I have a three-part question. First of all, in our family courts, we have an overload of cases coming to the Supreme Court and heated custody battles. We have laws in place here, such as SB 263, where joint is a preference. A lot of times people will spend all the money they have in order to see their own children and to gain custody. And we have right now we have an appeals court that is was put in place the Supreme Court called the Access to Justice Committee or Access to Justice. A lot of indigent litigants can't bring forth appeals to the Supreme Court, costing at least a minimum of $10,000-$20,000 to bring these up. And a lot of times those cases are affirmed. In your guys' opinion, is it what would be the best recourse on getting justice and being able to see their own children, and then actually having access to justice on those decisions that were made biasly or made egregiously in those cases? There's such an influx. So if you guys could go on that part, if you could comment to that, I'd appreciate it.
Okay, I'll start. Access to justice is obviously a very important issue, and it's certainly true that most folks cannot afford an attorney for a piece of litigation that requires, anything more than a simple hearing, and that is a problem that we need to address. Now, specifically with regard to family court issues, we do have a large percentage of the folks in family court representing themselves because they cannot afford counsel. Now, we do have great work going on at the Legal Aid Center of Southern Nevada, which not only do they have counsel, but they get attorneys to provide pro bono services to participate and take on some of those cases to help out folks who cannot afford an attorney on their own. In addition to that, we have these self-help centers, both at the Family Court and at the Regional Justice Center here in Las Vegas. Where folks who are representing themselves can get at least a little bit of help and guidance and the proper forms to proceed.
1 minute. Okay. Instead of finish, or you can finish.
I'm good, thank you.
I'm sorry.
No, it's okay.
Right. As a general jurisdiction judge up in Lyon County, I do family law. So, two-thirds of the cases I do is family law. And we don't have half of the resources, not even 80%. We're nowhere near the resources you have down here in Clark County. And it's a problem. And I think part of the things that the Supreme Court needs to do is, again, it's Supreme Court should be pushing the legislature and the executive branches to come up with more resources to help people out. It shouldn't be the courts through a fee raised every time you sell a piece of property. It shouldn't be dependent on getting three county commissioners to vote on that ordinance. We need the resources to help people out. And if we're not helping our families, then where are we going to go as a community? And the Supreme Court, again, needs to have a bigger role in the legislature and get more funds to take care of the issues you've raised.
With regard to your issue about the influx of cases and inattention to them, in Clark County, we're impacted much worse, and we started down a path that His Honor didn't have up in the 3rd Judicial District, and that is we stripped away from general jurisdiction this family court specialty. And there's an awful lot of inbreeding there and cliquishness in that type of court and that court type of court situation. It is not a statewide problem, but a Clark County problem that's going to have to be addressed by funding. I hate to say that, I've given that in 3 answers so far, but we need to have augmentation. We're not going to get more judges from the legislature. We have quite a few all over already, but they do need to work harder. They need to have help from more masters who are trained and are held to a very high ethical standard.
And the due process and the Constitution is not followed in family law a lot of times as well. So.
Yes, it all depends upon the quality of the judges.
Yeah, so
I apologize.
That's okay. We're just trying to keep it even so everybody gets fair. So I'm going to send it over to our assemblyman. I know you said 3 parts. If we have time, we'll come back to yours. Thank you, Mr. McDonald.
John Moore. What are each of your opinions on civil asset forfeiture prior to being convicted of a crime? It seems like that would be highly unconstitutional. But then you're taking my money, my property, without me being convicted, and I have to essentially pay you, the court, or pay an enormous fee to lawyers to get a percentage of my money or of that back, and I've not been convicted of anything. Where do you stand on that, each of you?
I find it problematic, and I've read a lot of cases. I don't deal with it. Metro has a section of lawyers who deal with it, going to court and then daring the people to come forward. So every day there are 4 of them in the paper and the legal notices this morning. It was first used in mob-related cases, and then it was used in drug-related cases, and then the use is expanded. Unless the money is found with the drugs, I would be, I think it's a horrible miscarriage of justice. Now, I can't intellectually tell you why I have that gut feeling, but just a forfeiture of money. And of course, you know, it's always usually suspicious because it's huge amounts of cash. So I think, you know, it's a question of legislation, and it needs to be addressed by more judicial discretion in finding those forfeitures to be inappropriate.
In my view, it all comes back to our constitutional right to due process, and the government cannot take our property without due process of law. And so there certainly needs to be a process where if the government is seeking to forfeit your property, they have to file in court and meet the burden of proof to show that in fact the property was used for illegal purposes. You can't just, you know, take the property and make the person whose property was taken have to try to figure out where to go in court. That seems to be the reverse of the process that ought to be in place. And I see that sometimes where there will be a criminal case, they'll plead down to something or there's some resolution, and then the defendant is trying to file a motion to get property returned, which is fine, and I may need to deal with those, but it seems like the government seeking to keep the property should be the one to have to file something to say we get to keep it, rather than the reverse.
In terms of my experience, the issue comes in with the due process. If you have someone sitting in a county jail trying to figure out how to oppose a forfeiture, no law library, no pens, pencils, that's where the unconstitutionality comes in. In theory, it is constitutional. But I think as the courts, we need to make certain that it's a real procedural due process, and we're not just throwing up some type of sham. Yeah, this was filed, that was filed, and he had his 2 minutes. So I think the courts need to be more aware, and I think it's more of an issue on the district court side than perhaps an appellate court. But again, you know, the district court judges making sure that procedural due process is followed.
Thank you.
Mr. McDonald, you have a follow-up. Would you like to?
I would like to ask that, Michael McDonald, for record, that a lot of the cases that that we are currently seeing, are being affirmed. There hasn't been as much justice, especially in regards to family law. About 80-90% get affirmed, and there's actually legitimate cases and cases that could be case law, yet they never get to that process or to that level or completely reviewed. And a lot of pro se litigants can't afford the transcripts and do all the process and not have the access to the attorney. So in your opinion, well, what could you guys do to vet those cases and actually see, because the devastation that it's caused, they come to the Supreme Court to seek justice, to get some kind of relief, yet no relief is applied, and they spend thousands of dollars and hours of time to bring those cases to you guys, or to the Supreme Court, and they get nothing, no relief.
Again, as a general jurisdiction judge in the rurals, we have to prioritize our cases. In the Third Judicial District, we prioritize family law cases. We give them the utmost. We have the ability to do a divorce in 90 to 120 days, contested. All right, unless the attorneys want to screw around and play discovery games and so forth, we can do it quickly. And you want to do it quickly because these people shouldn't be in the court to begin with. You know, it's unfortunate that they're not able to resolve their own issues, and that there's emotional baggage, and then there's problems. But they come before the court again. Its core mission is to resolve the issues. One of the issues that the Supreme Court's been raising in different family law conferences is the issue of bringing up in terms of the record. The Court of Appeals and the Supreme Court have been complaining that they're not getting the complete record. The judges aren't writing complete orders. Therefore, they spend a year and a half up in the Supreme Court. It's sent back because the judge's findings weren't specific enough. So I think there's been some educational attempts to get the orders better, but maybe this is something where we start considering the records and helping out with some money so the Supreme Court or the Court of Appeals can actually get a decent record to review.
It seems to me, and I take your question to be largely, well, I guess partly at least addressing what happens when they go up on appeal. And on the one hand, obviously, the appeal judges can't rule on the matter and can't evaluate it unless they have the record. But if someone is able to establish that they are indigent, they can apply for informa pauperis status. It seems to me if that's established, then they should be able to get a transcript prepared to have a record up on appeal, and if they're unable to pay for that.
Or an appointed attorney.
Or an appointed attorney, yeah.
And we don't have that due process or Fifth or Sixth Amendment right in family court.
And that's a bigger picture, because we have the rulings that are very clear now that you have a right to counsel as a criminal defendant, but that doesn't apply or hasn't yet been applied in the civil and family context, and that's an interesting question. Now, obviously, it would cost a whole lot of money if we start going down that path, but we may decide that it's so important for folks to get justice that we need to be able to provide some kind of counsel to people in those cases, because obviously it's important to have counsel if your life is on the line in a criminal case, but certainly custody of your children is no less important in someone's life. So I don't know, I mean, I would have to look at all the consequences of a decision like that, but we do need to look at that issue.
The most important issue that I think that you've identified is the lack of a transcript and the order. And so the Supreme Court is going to have to start, and the Court of Appeals, to be more forceful with the district judges, requiring them to exercise. I mean, it's a terrible thing to write an order. Believe me, I'd rather be whipped than write an order. But and most judges, in most cases, simply have the lawyers write them. When people are in proper person, they don't have that. So they've got to have the transcript. The court has, we have court fees all over the place. Any one of those could be channeled to the preparation of transcripts for those who are in financial need, in forma pauperis, as it's called. It's not a big thing in federal court. You fill out a form. Most of the people who are improper in state court are, you know, capable of doing that. It's not a, most people hesitate when they see something to do with a legal paper. It should be not complex. But the judges are going to have to also start doing a lot more work, like looking at papers themselves, digging through the documents that prisoners file. You don't need a law clerk to summarize it. You can look at it to see if there's a constitutional issue there. I've done it as a law clerk.
Okay, so Mr. McDonald, I know you have another one, probably. I'm going to go back to the panelists. Who else has another question? Mr.
Rob Lauer. There has not been an execution in the state since 2006. We have people on death row since 1979. Number one, do you support the death penalty? Number two, will you help to, as a Supreme Court justice, streamline the systems, obviously protecting people's civil rights, but what are you going to do to streamline the system so people are not on death row for 30 years?
First of all, I am in favor of the death penalty. Its imposition has had, or lack of imposition, has been had little to do with our state courts. The federal courts, after there's an exhaustion of state remedies, it then becomes a question of the federal court. We're in the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals, in which judges make the law. They show no judicial restraint, and they've effectively shut down executions. That has to change on the federal level. We have a dual court system, a federal court system, and when the federal court system finds that there's been a potential deprivation of due process of law in the state proceedings, federal law governs. That's how we work. But runaway judges on the federal court are the reason we have the problem. It is not fully borne by our own judiciary.
As noted, of course, we do have the death penalty available under Nevada law. It's available in only a narrow set of circumstances. It's only in first-degree murder cases, and within that, only in the narrow set of circumstances where there's an aggravated circumstance under Nevada law. And certainly, as a district judge, I have followed that. I have tried death penalty cases, and I have been in a position to sign a death warrant in those cases. Now, as you noted, there's been appeals, and that was stayed, and then it goes through the rest of the process. I think it's very important that we have our judges on the appeals of death penalty cases taking a close look, and if it takes some extra time to do that, that's what's needed, because it's very, and we do have the habeas process. As you know, I had one case come up on habeas. It wasn't a death penalty case, thank goodness, because I found that this man who was in prison for 21 years for a murder, that in fact he was actually innocent and did not commit it. And so I know it's very frustrating to see cases languish in the system, and I too am frustrated by that, but at the same time, we need to make sure that everyone's rights are protected and that we make sure someone who is innocent is not executed.
As to the death penalty, Nevada has legislation that allows it. The people have spoken. It's not up to the judges to determine that it should go away or you shouldn't use it. Personally, as a district attorney, I signed a death penalty notice. Again, you have to, as a prosecutor, look at those. I think as Judge Kadish mentioned, as in terms of the aggravators, it's important that the courts pay particular attention to the aggravators and ensure that the prosecutors aren't bringing questionable cases. In terms of death penalty, it's not really an area where we should be trying to make new law. But I think I'd agree more with Mr. Lefevre, though, that the real problem is the Ninth Circuit. Every judicial training you go to, this is the law, except if you're in the Ninth Circuit. And it's frustrating because we all know what the law is, what it should be, but some panel in San Francisco will decide, no, we're not going to do that today.
A minute.
And then we're all stuck with dealing with the ramifications of that.
So hold on. Hello, Mr. McDonald. Is there any other panelists who want to give it? Okay, go ahead. So,
yep.
State your name, please.
Andre Haynes. This is all you. If someone was wrongfully incarcerated for decades and released, what is their legal recourse, and what do you think the financial debt is owed to them on the courts going forward?
My understanding is that at this time Nevada doesn't have a law providing for compensation in that circumstance. I don't know whether someone in the legislature will attempt to change that, but certainly that's not my role as a judge.
I'd echo that as well. I think that's something in the realm of the legislature. They need to address it and determine. It doesn't happen often, but it does happen. And when it does happen, as human beings, we would think that we would try to help someone out who has been wrong to that extent. But that's something that has to come from the legislature. I would hope that you wouldn't have appellate judges creating such a scheme to reimburse people.
To segue off that question,
the only thing worse than taking an innocent person's life is taking away 20 years at a time. And so it is a legislative act. I frankly don't know why the legislature hasn't acted. There have been a number of cases. I believe a couple of those have heard. The person has filed a lawsuit and has recovered without a law being passed that permits it. But I can't imagine how heartbreaking that must be to family members and to the person whose life has been ruined a huge chunk of it taken away. I mean, it's just mind-boggling to think that could occur. Ordinary recourse is there, but a statutory entry into court with something would be very abbreviated as far as a court system, I think, would be very advisable litigation or legislation. I mean.
Okay, so anybody else on the panel?
Okay, yes, Ryan. Judge Eversary, you mentioned wanting to make the court more efficient. And the other candidates mentioned what they would do, but I didn't hear it.
Well, in terms of, again, it all comes down, I'm talking to veterans, so I'm trying to use some veteran speak in terms of what is the mission. All right, and that's where I think the Supreme Court has to sit down and they have to focus in terms of what are the priorities. Now, you have different types of cases, you have different, you have family law, which to me, again, family first. The family should be the priority in any court system because our societies are based upon families. And if families are stuck it's not good. These kids are hurting. They're not prospering as they should. So I think in terms of if I'm elected to the Supreme Court, I would sit down with staff. We'd have to go through all of our processes. We'd have to sit down and figure out what are our priorities, and we would have to start changing what our staff is doing. And in terms of rule changing, we can change all the rules in the world, but until we have a priority in place that these cases are going to get resolved, we're just spinning wheels.
Okay, did you want to come back and rebuttal on that?
I mean, I agree. I don't know if you needed any more information.
You already spoke to that. Okay.
Did you want to hear from Mr. Rufino?
If he has something he wants to say, sure.
I really hate to criticize the current court. I know all of the justices. There's going to be a massive turnaround in the court. There already has, as far as these three seats that are going to be open and changing quickly. But most respectfully, the court does spend way too much time on commissions. The justices have too many extracurricular activities, in my opinion. Some can fulfill that role well, wearing both hats as a public official. They're elected, they have a right to try to retain their seats and be well known in the communities and known for that. But there's too much time on commissions and time taken away from the drudgerous work being a judge. It requires being a cloistered person, applying great intelligence to a very complicated set of facts and pumping out decisions, and you can't do that when you're playing a political role. Sorry to say that.
Okay. Did you want to?
That's fine. Go.
So, okay. I know the assemblyman wants to at least state your name.
John Moore. I realize this is primarily a federal issue, but it is something that you may encounter at the Supreme Court level of the state. Where do you fall on this whole sanctuary city issue and judges refusing to enforce the law on folks that may or may not be in our country illegally? And, you know, what is their right to our to constitutional protections when they're not U.S. citizens?
You want to start?
I'll start on that. I think I'll answer from a broader perspective as to the problem you have when people start deciding these laws aren't going to be applied. All right? It goes both ways with the judges, and it goes also with the other branches of government. You know, as a history major, I remember Andrew Jackson. His famous quote, John Marshall has made his decision, now let him enforce it. So if we're going to get down into a path where we have the executive branch telling the judicial branch we're not going to enforce your decisions, and we have the judicial branch telling the executive branch we're not going to enforce the laws that you're supposed to enforce, and at the same time we're telling the legislature we don't care what your laws are, we'll apply what we want. That is not the system of federalism that Hamilton, Jay, and Madison discussed in the Federalist Papers. And so, like I'm saying, you can have your cause de jure of the day, but again, as a country, we're heading down a terrible path.
My role as a citizen district judge, and if I'm lucky enough to be elected to this Nevada Supreme Court seat, is obviously to follow and enforce the law. It's not my job to create the law, that's up to the legislature. And as a judge, I have and will follow the law as it exists. That's the job as a judge. And so that's the role that I play and what I would do. It's certainly not my job to decide what immigration law should or shouldn't be. That's up to the legislature, and when that's decided, as at those cases come before me as a judge, I'll follow them.
A Nevada Supreme Court justice takes an oath to support the Nevada Constitution and the federal Constitution. And so should an issue come forward, I can't tell you how I would rule, yeah, especially in the abstract. But we have something called the Supremacy Clause, and state law and state local efforts fall when the federal government decrees something. So this is just like the marijuana issue. The prior administration said we're not going to enforce. Then we switch ponies, and then suddenly the new one says it's totally a lack of the role of the rule of law and an erosion of it that's been set forth in our judiciary like a wild plague. With regard to Nevada, we have a peculiar provision in our Constitution. It's called the Paramount Purpose Clause, and it says the paramount, because we were a foreign state in the Civil War, that we have an extra duty to enforce laws of the United States. And it was imposed on some southern states of Nevada. So it's not for judges to be making laws and decide when laws will be enforced.
Okay, so we have time for one more question. There you go, Ms. McDonald.
All right, this Michael McDonald. I do have a question, and it's also coming from the Facebook feed as well. Well, if you guys are elected to the Supreme Court, will you guys enforce Title 18, Section 242, which is an official acting under color of law that violates your constitutional rights? They can be imposed or commits a felony under that statute. We have a lot of judicial officers, attorneys, police, and judges that are violating people's constitutional rights, yet they are not being prosecuted under that title. And I would also like to ask that if your understanding of the law, do you believe that statutes are law? So the Title 18, Section 242.
Statutes are law, and federal statutes are binding upon state court judges and Supreme Court judges as well. That's a provision of the federal United States Code annotated. Rarely is it going to be before a state judge, because most of those are part of what's called exclusive federal jurisdiction. Civil rights actions can be filed before district courts, and it would be, if considered upon appeal, certainly the law, I would enforce as it's written, and not engage in second guessing if the facts are lend themselves to supporting an award under the statute.
Such as 1983 statute, right?
Yes, and that's regardless of what the law is. We're not vying for this office to become super legislators or to impose our wisdom upon what's been vetted in the legislature or in the Congress. Our role is quite limited, and it should be, and we should all be blessed with judicial restraint in not acting outside the realm of what we've been elected for.
I can't say I'm familiar with the particular statute you're citing, but certainly I agree that judges need to follow the law and the Constitution, and if they are ignoring that, then there certainly should be consequences, whether judicial discipline or, more seriously, if it would be a crime. But of course, if that happens, if that's a federal crime, it would be up to the federal authorities to pursue and bring any charges, and that wouldn't be something I would be involved in. As noted under 42 U.S.C. Section 1983, you can bring a civil claim for damages for violation of constitutional rights, and certainly when I have cases before me that make claims under that statute, just like in any other case, there needs to be discovery, file motions, examine it, and determine whether in fact the claim has been proven, and I'll certainly follow the statute and what the constitutional law is that applies in that case.
Yeah, in the third judicial, we don't get a lot of civil rights lawsuits in terms of the court. Most of my experience was previously as a district attorney defending against them, different county officers. I'll just echo, in terms of the, it's not up to the judges, and it's certainly not up to appellate judges to enforce. You know, we interpret, we find, we rule. Enforcement's really an executive branch of action. They're the ones who prosecute. They're the ones who bring it forward. But as a judge, certainly if someone comes and proves a case, you know, I'll follow the law, and you'll see an order stating that you proved your case.
But they don't follow the law, should they be held accountable under Title 18, Section 242?
Well, and that's the question again. I hear it in a couple of, especially your questions, the accountability. And again, now we can't recall judges in the state of Nevada. Accountability is going to be really important. And as to whether or not that's through a private lawsuit, which might be an unintended consequence of taking away the right to recall.
Because they don't have immunity under that, like most of them.
Right. But like I said, you have to follow the law, whether it's federal or state.
Panelists, esteemed panelists, thank you so much for your questions. Judges and Mr. Lefevre, thank you so much. So I want to give you 2 minutes to give your elevator speech or your campaign speech, what you want, and why the voters should vote for you. So who would like to go first?
What do you say?
No, that's the reason.
Okay.
My name's Alan Lefevre. I'm a lawyer with a vast experience. I think the qualities that are needed in a judge are a very good background in the law. I've practiced in most every area of the law in Nevada. Not a lot of time in family court matters. The ugly part of the job is that it requires somebody to be a little bit of a book nerd, and a justice must be prepared to spend probably 5 to 7 hours every day studying, reading, looking at briefs. It's a very hard job. It requires a great deal of attention. The court gets to hear arguments, but that's only every other week, usually for a few hours. The rest of it is very solitary work, and it is work that, if elected to do, I would do, and I believe I would bring a great deal of intelligence to it based upon my extensive background and very good judgment. Judicial restraint, not thinking that you're a super legislator, is incredibly important. And the very last attribute has to be a great deal of concern about what is languishing and what agony is occurring because of inaction. Family court cases in which custody is hanging and disruption in the family occurs, that simply has to be solved. And if it's to devote the Court of Appeals solely to that task, that's what I would undertake to do.
So I grew up back east in New York and New Jersey. I went to college at the University of Pennsylvania, graduated with honors from there, went to law school at the University of Virginia, where I was on the law review and graduated with honors from there as well. I came to Nevada in 1989, right after law school, came here for a 2-year clerkship with a federal judge, Judge Philip Froh, who's my hero, mentor, and friend. And after clerking for him for 2 years, I decided to stay in Nevada, which was not what my original intention was, but I found a lot of opportunity here. I also met my future husband while clerking for Judge Froh. I practiced commercial litigation and employment law with a couple of different firms before getting appointed to the district court bench in 2007 by Governor Jim Gibbons. I ran in 2008 and got retained to my seat, ran again in 2014. I was unopposed that time, and now I am seeking election by the folks of Nevada to the Nevada Supreme Court. As a district judge, I've shown that I will treat everyone with courtesy and respect. I will work very hard. I will rule based on the facts and the law and treat everyone fairly, ensure justice for all of our citizens. I also show that I'm a leader in the community, not only in the legal community, but in the community at large. I was president of the Women Attorneys Organization. I sat on the Carr County Bar Board of Directors. I am the chair of the State Bar's We the People Committee. I am on the board of the Jewish Family Service Agency. And I think it's very important that we show ourselves to be leaders in the community and role models for our young people in the state of Nevada. And I think I've done that, and I would appreciate your vote.
And it's Judge Leon Aberster. I've been a district court judge up in the 3rd Judicial District for the last 10 years. Prior to that, I was a Lyon County District Attorney. And then prior to that, I was a Deputy DA for Lyon County and Battle Mountain. I have experience in the rural counties. All right, these are small communities. They have problems that most of the people in Clark County, Reno, don't even think about. Now, I know the argument falls kind of flat when I'm down in Clark County, but there's 17 counties in this state. 15 of them do not have any representation on the